Welcome back on the MetaMath webinar series. Today we have the great pleasure to welcome Professor Agnès Morel and Professor Kim Pham. So Agnès is the Director of Research at CNRS in Institut Langevin at the École Supérieure de Physique et Chimie Industrielle of Paris. And Kim is an Assistant Professor at UNSTA, which is on the Palaiseau campus of École Polytechnique. And today they are going to present some wonderful results on resonant homogenization in metafilms. It's your turn.
Okay, so thank you, Sébastien. Thank you, ma mère. And thank you, Bogdan, for this kind invitation. And thank you for your energy to organize this very nice weekly meeting. So it's really a pleasure to be part of it. So today, indeed, we will talk about homogenization of resonant metafilm, and resonant metafilm is this kind of device, a set of, say, meta-atoms organized periodically along a plane. Both the dimension of the atom and their spacing are sub-wavelengths. Nevertheless, the device can have a huge impact on an incoming wave as each atom presents a sub-wavelength resonance. And we are going to see if it is possible, thanks to homogenization, to propose effective model where these structures are replaced by a simpler one where the discrete repartition of the atom is replaced by an analog continuous one. So I would like to mention that this work that is presented by myself and Kim Pham has been done in close collaboration with Jean-Jacques Marivaux. And today I would like to thank him warmly as since 5 years, a little bit more than 5 years, he has opened my mind on these nice techniques of homogenization and also on problem of elastodynamic. So, but today we will speak about acoustics, and we have chosen three resonances that I will comment briefly. Firstly, the Helmholtz resonance, the most famous for acoustic wave. So as you know, if you insonify the bottle, you will hear a sound which corresponds to a wavelength much larger than the dimension of the bottle. So this is known for a long time. Amphorae called Echea were used in the Greek theater and later on in churches and mosques to modify the acoustic of the place. And nowadays they are used as a metafilm, metasurface, or here, this metaline. So in this case, it is a metaline of resonator able to produce a rainbow trapping effect. So the second resonance is the Minnert resonance. It is associated with an oscillation, a radial oscillation of an air bubble in water. And the resonance is sub-wavelength due to the large contrast in the mass density between air and water. So again, it is known for a long time, at least by some marine mammals, which fabricate this bubbly cage to catch fishes. It has been rediscovered during the Second World War by the German Navy that built, in fact, anechoic tiles to protect their submarine from the signal of sonar. And these tiles are basically rubber tiles filled with bubbly liquid, with air bubble, in fact. So this bubbly film have been studied in the context of metamaterial, in particular in my institute. And one of the main difficulties is to realize well-controlled array. But you see that there is some recent work which suggests that we can make now a very complex array. So probably to explore new configuration. And eventually, the Mi resonance, which is probably the most intuitive one, and I think the first example of difference between the geometrical cross-section and the effective scattering cross-section in electromagnetism. So the resonance is the resonance of a dielectric inclusion in which the wavelength is of the order of the diameter. So the resonance is very intuitive. It is nevertheless subwavelength with respect to the incoming wave in the matrix, as there is a large contrast in the celerity between the inclusion and the matrix. So this kind of inclusion organized as along an array have been studied in electromagnetism, in particular to produce the so-called dressing effect. And there is here an analog in elastodynamics if you consider a soft inclusion in a stiffer matrix. Okay, so let us start with the Helmholtz resonator. As I said, it is basically a bottle with two important pieces, a cavity and a neck. And the resonance is simply due to geometrical effect. A little bit more precisely, you can see the Helmholtz resonator as an intermediate device between a completely open cavity and a completely closed cavity. For the open cavity, we know that the lowest resonance corresponds to a node and an antinode, or Dirichlet and Neumann boundary condition, and it is a quarter wavelength resonance. In the opposite limit, we are looking for perfect resonance. And the lowest one is a uniform pressure with arbitrary high value within the cavity, and it is associated to zero frequency resonance. So the classical picture of the Helmholtz resonator is as follows: an almost uniform pressure within the cavity, as in the closed case, and a sudden pressure drop within the neck in order to have a Dirichlet boundary condition at the exit of the neck. And with this picture in mind, you can derive a rough estimate of the resonance frequency. So I specify here the dimension of the cavity and of the neck. We are dealing with a linearized Euler equation, so for acoustic wave. And if you integrate the equation of mass conservation over the cavity, you get a first relation where we have made use of the Green theorem and the fact that the velocity vanishes at each rigid boundary, so everywhere except at the entrance of the neck. We have also made use that the pressure is uniform. So in 2D here, you just recover the surface of the cavity. And using further that the velocity is uniform in the neck, we obtain a simple expression between the pressure drop and the time derivative of the velocity. So the pressure drop goes, the pressure drop corresponds to pressure P at the entrance of the neck and zero at the exit of the neck. And combining both relations, you obtain the equation of an oscillator, and in the harmonic regime, the resonant wave number Kr. So you see that when phi goes to zero, phi goes to zero, we recover a completely closed cavity, Kr is zero. But nevertheless, this estimate has two drawbacks. The first is that it does not recover the quarter wavelength resonance for open cavity. And this is expected as the pressure is no more uniform in the cavity. And by the way, the neck has disappeared. And the second drawback is that it does not recover neither the fact that if you consider a very thin neck, E goes to zero, imagine a soda can, the resonance is still subwavelength, and here it is not recovered because obviously the role of the evanescent field has not been taken into account. Okay, so but nevertheless, with or without estimate, you can measure the Helmholtz, and you can see the Helmholtz resonance by simply sending a plane wave on a bottle in a numerical experiment. Here, you measure the velocity amplitude in the neck, again the frequency, and the maximum of this amplitude give you the resonant wave number, and you see that indeed, at this resonance, the plane wave is significantly perturbed or disturbed by this small resonant bottle. Okay, so that's it for a single resonator. Now we want to move from one bottle to an array of bottles. And we have chosen this configuration, an hard wall in which we have placed an array, a periodic array of bottles. So now if you send a plane wave, you have a scattering problem characterized by the reflection coefficient. And if you report the variation of the real part of R, obviously R is of modulus 1. But if you plot the real part, you see that most of the time, R is 1. R is the reflection coefficient for the pressure. I did not precise that. So R equals 1, which means that the wall behaves as a rigid wall. It does not see the presence of the bottle. So rigid wall means associated with Neumann boundary condition. And suddenly, near the resonance, it goes to minus 1, which means that the wall has a transition from Neumann boundary condition to Dirichlet boundary condition. The pressure vanishes on the wall, and this is dictated by the behavior of the resonant bottle. Okay, so now we can think to modelize this system, and we have thought our homogenization procedure in order to correct the two drawbacks of the Wolf estimate. So firstly, we wanted a model able to cover the full range from the quarter wavelength resonance to the zero resonance, and this has been done thanks to bulk homogenization. And the second thing, obviously, is that we want our model to account for the effect of the evanescent field near the neck, and this has been done thanks to interface homogenization. So the first homogenization will interrogate really the propagation in the region of the cavity, and it is the most classical kind of homogenization. The second one is less classical. It consists in zooming in the region of the neck and to inspect the boundary layer effect. And I will not go into the detail of these two homogenizations, which are rather technical, but I just like to stress for this interface homogenization, which is not very classical, that it involves elementary static problems. So in the present case, the Laplace equation, so problem typically of potential flow, from which effective parameters are obtained. And there is something particular for this interface homogenization when compared to the bulk one, is that you still have elementary cells, but these elementary cells are unbounded in the direction when you move away from the interface. So they are unbounded here vertically. And the elementary problem that we have to consider in this case correspond to a vertical loading from which you obtain the first effective parameter. In fluid mechanics, it is this parameter B is called the blockage coefficient. And the second problem, where the external loading is vertical and which give rise or which provide a second effective parameter that we shall call C. Okay, so at the end of the day, you obtain an effective problem where the region of the cavity, thanks to bulk homogenization, have been replaced by an effective medium, which is homogeneous and, as you can guess, very anisotropic. And the interface homogenization provide jump condition across the region of the neck. And we have to add something at the bottom of the effective medium, which replaces the Neumann boundary condition which apply in each cavity. And here it is also a Neumann boundary condition, but which apply all along the x2 direction. Okay, and how mathematically, how look this effective problem? So it is written here. It is much longer to write than the actual one, but it is much simpler also to solve. So in the air, we recover the Euler equation in what is expected. In the region of the cavity, a slightly modified version, as you can see, the propagation is allowed only along E1, the vertical direction, which is expected also as the wave cannot propagate across the rigid wall, and you obtain a pressure jump and velocity jump, where these two parameters B and C appear, and here you just have a geometrical parameter. So I have not much to say on the jump on the velocity, but I would like to comment on the pressure drop in the neck. If you remember the heuristic calculation, we had a pressure jump within the neck, which were related to the velocity through this geometrical parameter, E divided by phi. And here, this E over phi is replaced by HB, with B the blockage coefficient. And it turns out that for this simple neck shape, we have an explicit expression of the blockage coefficient. So we recover the geometrical coefficient, the geometrical contribution that we can call, in fact, the propagating contribution. And this additional term, which encapsulates, in fact, the effect of the evanescent field. And as you see, the blockage coefficient can become much very significant with respect to this simple estimate. So we think that we have indeed corrected the first drawback of this heuristic calculation by accounted for the effect of the evanescent field. So to see if we are able to correct the second drawback, so cover the range from quarter wavelengths to zero frequency resonance, the most simple is to assume a simple harmonic time dependence and to interrogate a simple scattering problem. So in this case, as you know, the equation of propagation in each medium and accounting for the Neumann boundary condition at x1 equal minus L, you can write the general explicit solution of this problem. So here we just account for the fact that we have Neumann boundary condition and a certain wave number. Here you have just a superposition of the incoming and reflected wave. And obviously, you have two unknown, A and R, which are simply given by the two jump condition. So we have an explicit solution to this problem, and I report it here, the reflection coefficient. At theta equals zero, sorry, it contains already all the information we need, so we can write it for any theta, obviously. And what you see is that to recover the resonance, which means the Dirichlet boundary condition, R equal minus one, we have to cancel this quantity, which means that we have to find the intersection between the cotangent in the is the inverse of the tangent, so of this blue curve, with a line of slope HB. And if you remember, this simple shape, the form of HB, you see that we can cover the case of the open cavity when E equals zero, you remove the neck, and phi equal one, phi equal one, sorry. So the slope is zero, B zero, and you can go up to the completely closed cavity when phi goes to zero and B diverges. So we have correct indeed the two drawbacks, and we can now have a look on the accuracy of the model. So here you will see a movie. On the movie, there is a trick. We have in fact two distinct part. One is the pressure field obtained from direct numerical simulation, And starting from after this line on the right part, you have the effective model corresponding to this expression with A and R explicit. And you can guess that it is like that because you see that here the region of the bottle is a plain region. There is no microstructure and you don't see the neck neither. Here it is a zoom. Here you see the neck. Here you don't see the neck because this region is not resolved. You just have the jump condition applying between this point and this point. And what we shall do in the animation is to shrink the neck, so to reduce the neck opening. And this is what you observe. So in reflection coefficient, the result is not very impressive because you have just a phase shift in the reflection coefficient. Here you see you have Dirichlet boundary condition, we are at resonance, and then again we tend to the Neumann boundary condition. And when the cavity is almost closed, you clearly have, obviously, a Neumann boundary condition. And we can repeat the game if you open the cavity at both ends. So now we have an explicit solution with two scattering coefficients, two unknown amplitude, but now we have four relations, two at this across this neck and two relations across this neck. And we do the same game, same representation between numerics and explicit solution. Effective explicit solution when closing the neck. So here, obviously, the effect is more visual as we are in reflection and transmission. Okay. So I will end this part dedicated to the Helmholtz resonator with a few words concerning ongoing work. Firstly, we have been interested recently in proposing effective model for some array. So here, there is no neck for simplicity. So for array where we break some symmetry. So here we have broken symmetry. And obviously, so the interface homogenization will be very similar to what we have done previously. What is very new here is that we have two non-identical channels associated with two different solutions. But it turns out that it is possible to account for these two different solutions considering two effective media. And this effective media does not communicate in the region of the cavity, but they will communicate through the jump condition. And we know that these systems are very particular, as they present trap mode, which are prevented, quasi-trap mode, which are prevented by symmetry in the regular array. So at near the resonance of this quasi-trap mode, you can have very particular shape of the field. So here, it is this geometry with ultra-thin wall of the cavity. And you see the two solutions in one channel and in the neighboring channel, where obviously, so here we have separated the solution for lisibility. P hat and P check are very similar outside the array, but strongly differ within the array. And again, here you see a comparison between direct numerics, the blue and red curve, and the effective model in black dashed line. And this is the ongoing work of Joarzu Ockström, who is currently doing his PhD thesis in ENSTA. And eventually, a very recent work considers the case of array of this form. So it's a different array, it's also a different scaling that we have to do. and that we think to perform in acoustic and in electromagnetism. And this is the starting work of Sarah Tachet, in ENSTA. Okay, so that's all for this first family of resonators, and I will now give the floor to Kim Pham.
Okay, so I will continue the presentation with the two remaining resonances we wanted to show you. So namely the Mi resonance in elastodynamic and the Minert resonance again in acoustics. So let's start with the Mi resonance in elastodynamic. So the starting point here is this row of elastic inclusion, which is periodically distributed along the direction x2. And we assume at first no contrast between the inclusion and the matrix. And we work here in antiplane elasticity, where the unknowns are the antiplane scalar displacement u and the associated stress field sigma. And well, this obviously this can be extended to a higher dimension, but for this talk we will present it in antiplane elasticity. So to work in the homogenized domain regime, we assume that the array has a sub-wavelength microstructure, so which means that the periodicity H is much smaller than the incident wavelength, and so it gives rise to a small parameter eta, which is equals to kh. And so in the limit, it's possible to homogenize the system, and we obtain the resulting the geometry where the region of inclusion has been replaced by jump conditions, and the effective model looks like this. Outside the region, so we have homogeneous wave propagation in the matrix, so classical wave propagation, and across the region you have jump conditions. So for sake of completeness, when you do the asymptotics, so you go at different order, if you stop at the dominant order, you have only continuity conditions on the field. So it means that the interface is transparent at the dominant end in the asymptotics. So for instance, you will have perfect transmission. So if you want to retrieve at least the non-trivial behavior of the interface, you have to go at least at the first order, and you obtain such kind of jump conditions where you have the jump on the displacement and the jump on the normal stress. And this involves three different parameters. One, which is the geometric parameter S, and two effective parameters B and C, which can be calculated, as Agnes showed, using elementary problems. And this effective parameter depend only on the geometry of the microstructure and the material properties. And in this example where we didn't assume any contrast between the materials, these effective parameters do not depend on the frequency. Okay, so to compare the effective model to the direct numerics or the initial problem, here we consider rectangular inclusions and we look at a scattering problem of plane wave at oblique incidence, theta. And we know that for the direct problem, at sufficient low frequency, you only have one transmitted wave and one reflected wave. So this can be solved numerically using here modal methods. And we also solved the effective problem, which can be done analytically. And we obtain the reflection coefficient R and the transmission coefficient T as functions of the effective parameters B, C, and S, and the angle theta. So here we have a comparison between the direct numerics and the effective model on the numerical fields, and we see good agreement between the model and the direct numerics. So if we go further in the analysis, we can look at the value of the coefficients R and T. So here the norm of the coefficients. And what you observe are a very weak influence of the interface. Here we see that R is pretty small. So if we want to increase the effect of the interface, we have to rely on resonant inclusion. Okay. So the starting point of the problem is to look at here the eigen problem of a single inclusion for which we impose here Dirichlet boundary conditions. So the eigen problem looks like this. And we can solve it numerically, and we find the different eigen modes here are different orders. But what is important to have in mind here is how the resonant frequency scale with respect to the material parameters. And we know that the resonant frequency here scale obviously as the celerity of the medium of the inclusion divided by the characteristic length of the medium. So having this in mind, if we come back now to our initial configuration, if you want to work in a regime where the inclusions have a resonant behavior, we must enforce not only the subwavelength feature of the array, but also we have to make a scaling between the resonant frequency and the frequency of excitation. Specifically, we have to say that the resonant frequency of the inclusion is of the same order than the frequency of excitations. And this will hold even if small parameter eta goes to zero. You will always keep the resonant behavior. So if you have in mind the value of the resonant frequency that we talked earlier, this gives rise to some scalings on the material contrast. Here, two different scalings, one which says that the mass density of the inclusion and the mass density of the matrix has to be of the same order. And the second scaling is that the stiffness of the inclusion has to be much weaker than the stiffness of the matrix, specifically in eta squared. And by doing so, you will have naturally a contrast in celerities between the inclusion and the matrix, which will tell you that you will be able to encapsulate a wavelength inside the inclusion of the same order than the characteristic length. So your inclusion will have a transient behavior, even if you are in the subwavelength region. Okay, so this problem can be homogenized doing asymptotics using the two scale methods similarly than the Helmholtz resonator that Agnès showed before. And you obtain this set of effective problems, homogeneous wave equations outside the region of the inclusion. And the region of the inclusion is replaced by a jump condition. So these jump conditions, they almost look the same than before, except the presence of an additional term, which is precisely frequency dependent and depends on the resonant frequencies of a single inclusion submitted to Dirichlet boundary conditions. And in particular, this parameter D can be singular near the resonant frequencies. Okay. So to compare the effective problem to the direct problem, we come back again to the scattering problem. And we look here at the scattering of a normal wave at oblique incidence. And for the effective problem, the problem can be solved again explicitly. And you find the reflection coefficient R and the transmission coefficient T as a function of the effective parameter, the angle of incidence, and precisely now, the additional term, which is the frequency dependent. So here is the profile of the scattering of the reflection coefficients versus KH at 40 degrees. And you see that contrary to the non-resonant case of before, now you have a strong accident in the scattering properties, And you have here the presence of a Fano resonance, meaning a perfect transmission followed by a perfect reflection. So here we plot the value of the field as is at this near the Fano resonance, where you have perfect transmission and perfect reflection. And for a more visual or more funny way to see that, here we change on this video, so the value of KH across all the Fano resonance. So you see that here we are at the perfect transmission, so we are at this point, and we go progressively to the perfect reflection, and then the frequency starts to grow again, and we move out from the perfect reflection. Okay, so how does the model behave if you go higher in frequencies, and is it able to capture the higher resonant frequencies? So here we have a complete, let's say, a more complete picture of the scattering coefficients across KH. And what we see is that the effective model, which is in black, is able to capture a certain number of eigenfrequencies, but not all of them. So especially, it is able to capture the eigenfrequencies associated to non-zero average eigenmode. But the zero average eigenmode here, which have here high quality factor, are missed by the effective model. So it's not that, or at least this is what we think, it's not that the homogenization procedure has failed. It's probably that we have not go high enough in the asymptotics, and to catch these eigenfrequencies with a higher quality factor, you have to go higher in the asymptotics. So the second resonance, or the third resonance we wanted to deal with, is the Minnert resonance. And so we come back to the acoustic case, and the starting point here, again, is to look at a single resonator. So namely, or precisely here, a bubble of gas inside a liquid of infinite extent. So we assume that this bubble, at least for first assumption, can be modeled by linear acoustic wave equations, so linear equations with continuity of the fields at interface. And we look for the monopolar resonances of such systems, precisely those which are associated to maximum amplitude in the bubble of gas. So if you do that, after derivation, you obtain an equation that gives you the resonant frequencies of the system. And precisely, you have to equate a tangent and a line of a certain slope. So if we plot the tangent here and the line with the slope 1 divided by 1 minus rho g divided by rho l, you obtain these two figures, and you see that the line crosses the tangent at different points. So for instance, these two points and the points beyond are associated to resonance for which the wavelength in the bubble is of the same order than its radius. Typically, here we are near 3 pi over 2. But you see also the presence of a resonance which is closer to the origin. And if you make a zoom, indeed, you see that the line crosses the tangent, and the line crosses the tangent closer to the origin as the contrast is bigger between the bubble and the liquid. So typically, for air water systems, you have a sub-wavelength resonance, which is the Minnert resonance, which is expressed here in terms of the contrast of mass densities and the celerity in the gas and its radius. So again, the goal is, knowing now how a single resonator works, how to deal with screens which are made of these Minnert resonators. So again, as for the mere resonance, we make basically two important assumptions. The first one, the sub-wavelength aspect of the screen. So the periodicity is small compared to the incident wavelength, and a resonant regime where we enforce that the resonant frequency of the resonator has to scale with the frequency of excitation. So that even in the sub-wavelength regime, when eta goes to zero, you still have a resonant metascreen. So knowing that the Minnett resonance for a single resonator is given by the formula, to enforce these two hypotheses, you have to make some scalings. So again, like me, to have a resonant regime, you must have contrast between materials properties or geometric properties. Without contrast, you don't have resonant behavior. And here the scaling look as this. You must have a celerity in the gas of the same order than the liquid. The mass density of the gas has to be much smaller than the liquid, and it has to be precisely in eta 4. And the screen of bubble has to be dilute, meaning that the radius of the bubble has to be much smaller than the periodicity. And here, the value of the scalings, here eta, eta 4, is very important because we are doing asymptotics after that. And if you do not precise correctly the power of the scalings, you will not be able to match correctly the asymptotics. Okay, so since we want to deal with possible high amplitude oscillations of bubble radius, we start with the Navier-Stokes equations. For the bubble and the gas, and we assume also a low Mach number in the liquid, so that in the limit, when you do the homogenization, you obtain a simple behavior of the liquid. So if you do the homogenization and you pass to the limit when eta is small, and you go to the first order, you obtain this resultant problem where the array of bubbles has been replaced by a screen which has the following properties. So outside the screen, you have classical Euler equations for the liquid. And this is because we assume a low Mach number, so the liquid stays linear, non-dispersive. However, when you cross the screen, the field experiences jump conditions. So precisely, the pressure is continuous, but the normal velocity experiences a jump. And this jump is related to the radius of the bubble. And here you have to note that now the radius of the bubble is not anymore a discrete parameter defined for each bubble. It is now a function which varies continuously with the position at the screen, because we pass to the limit for sub-wavelength array. And this radius of the bubble is governed by a modified Rayleigh-Plessette equation. And we say modified because it encapsulates some additional terms compared to the classical Rayleigh-Plessette equation, due to the fact that we have now a periodic screen. And it looks like this. Here we have the input of the second order nonlinear equations is the pressure at the screen. And this is also an unknown, because here we have a coupled system. So there are different ways to solve this system. You can solve it numerically. If you want to analyze more analytically the system, you can start with the analysis of the scattering of a normal plane wave that hits the screen here from the left to the right. And so because of the D'Alembert solutions and the fact that the pressure is continuous at the screen, know that the pressure on the left and on the right of the screen can be decomposed as the incident pressure plus the radiated pressure, which is emitted symmetrically by the screen. And if you simplify a bit further the problem, assuming a linear regime where the radius of the bubbles is not far away from the radius at equilibrium, you find here specifically the radiated pressure as a function of the velocity of the radius. And this radius is governed by the linearized red epicyte equations, which is a second order linear oscillator equations. And two important features of this oscillator equations is first the presence of radiative damping. So it's not a damping due to viscosity because we do not assume here any losses in the system. It's a damping due to the fact that the bubbles are not isolated. They are communicating with the exterior. And so they are releasing energy as time goes by. And you have also a shift of the Minard resonance. So you do not find exactly the Minard resonance of a single resonator in a liquid of infinite extent. You have a shift due to the periodicity, the periodic arrangement, because here the parameter delta that is involved here is related to a calculation of a Green function in a periodic grid. So this parameter delta encapsulates the fact that you have a periodic arrangement. So it shifted the Minard resonance. So again, we can look at how these bubble screens behave on the scattering problem. Here we sent a normal plane wave on the screen located here. Outside the resonant frequency, you have a scattering profile, reflection and transmission. And if you go close to the Minard resonance, you observe here a perfect reflection with a jump here on the normal velocity. So here, what we showed you, it was for the linear here regime analysis. But we can also analyze the non-linearities of this effective model. Here, what we plot is a spatiotemporal diagram with on this axis the time. Here the spatial coordinates, and the screen is located at x equals 0. And what we increase here is the amplitude of the incident pressure. So for sufficiently low amplitude, you are in a linear regime and you recognize more or less a classical scattering profile of wave. And as the amplitude is increasing, you observe that this profile is modified and is modified due to the non-linear behavior of the bubble screens. And you have a complicated shape for higher amplitudes. However, due to the fact that the liquid is non-dispersive, as soon as the bubble fabricates this non-linear behavior, this non-linear behavior travels without deformation in the liquid. And so to finish this presentation, we just give you some words on perspective on this Minard resonance. So what we showed you here was the effect of a bubble screen inside water. And one possible perspective is to investigate the case of anechoic tiles. So anechoic tiles are superabsorbers used to protect submarines. And they consist in a viscoelastic layer in which air bubbles are periodically or randomly distributed. And these anechoic tiles, their performances rely precisely on Minard resonance. So one perspective is to investigate the effective behavior of these anechoic tiles based on homogenization methods. And so for this, there is a postdoctoral position available on this topic. So feel free if some of your students or once also if some students here are interested. And another direction of investigation is to look at the effect of the arrangements of the bubble in the screen. So here, for the sake of simplicity, we have considered square arrangement, so very simple arrangement, but one possible way of investigating this bubble screen is to look at more complicated arrangement. And for this, we just started a collaboration with Pierre-Thomas Brun and Vincent Tournard, and it will be both analytically based on asymptotic techniques and experimentally, since now Pierre Thomas and his group is able to build some complicated viscoelastic layer with periodic arrangement with complex arrangements distributions. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Agnès and Kim, for this wonderful talk. So now we welcome any questions from people in the audience.